All right. So tonight we're going to talk about mutual funds. So we've kind of been building on this because, mutual funds are made primarily just most mutual funds. They can be comprised of different types of investments, but just about always they're made out of equities, as in stocks. So that's why it's important that we talk about stocks before. They can also have bonds. Sometimes they can have real estate. They can have whatever they want. I mean, there's not like a fixed list of, ingredients to be a mutual fund. Mutual funds are put together, for the purpose of selling them, to people. And so they can comprise what they think the consumer wants, and then they charge management fees and other little fees along the way that are not too bad as long as their performance is good. And so that's why, when you say mutual fund, it can mean a lot of things because it can contain a lot of different investment, assets. And the chance that you all will, that's pretty much 100%. You're all going to have some type of mutual fund at some point. And I can say that because, most of you are Alaskans. And if you look at the way the PFD is structured, the permanent fund dividend, it's essentially a mutual fund. We'll look at some of the assets they have, but it's the same sort of deal. And so, the notion with mutual funds is professional management, rather than you trying to pick individual stocks, you're letting somebody else do that for you. Now, if you watch the or listen to the little podcast thing, it's kind of interesting. It talks about index funds where, when the market's going straight up, which it had been for a long, long time, you didn't have to be, a great stock picker to do well. In fact, sometimes you were kind of hindered because if you would have just, kept out of it, number one, you would not have incurred a bunch of fees that you had to pass on to the customers. And also, you might have done better in terms of investments. So that's what that, if you don't know what I'm talking about, listen to the little homework assignment on the index fund podcast. We'll talk a little about index funds here in a second. So this graph that I plopped up there real quick, this is just to show you the, Dow Jones. So when I say 10% per year, I'm not just, pulling that number out of my whatever. It's actually, the charts will verify. So you can go back through history, you can say, oh, when was the Great Depression? Oh, right about there. And when was the drop in, 2007, 2008? And when I was talking about don't panic, don't sell, just hold tight, because look, if you just go across, granted it took a couple of years, but the worst thing you could have done is gone, oh, this is horrible. Yeah, it's really bad, really bad. And then you end up getting right out at the bottom. You can, it's human nature. It's far easier to get out at the bottom than to get out at the top. That's very difficult. But to just ride it out, that's hard to do, but sometimes that's what you got to do. So if you're in there now, especially if you're in the high tech stuff and some of the other things that I'm in, it's already happened. It's if you were going to sell, now this is kind of the time to ride it out. So anyway, so background on mutual funds, stock funds. So stock mutual funds, and yeah, most mutual funds are made from stock, but they typically don't, their titles will be something because they're it's all about marketing. So it'll be the the Sun Belt Equity Fund or the Emerging something or whatever. It's like they're selling prescription drugs or something where it's all marketing and it's just huge vast sums of money available to try and come up with a name to entice you to buy and invest. But they can also be comprised of bonds. All are managed by professional portfolio managers. Yeah, but this kind of flies in the face of what I was talking about, index people, where it doesn't really take a professional portfolio manager because there's not a lot of skill involved if you're just going to buy a certain number of shares of each stock under a certain index, and then you're not going to do anything and you're just going to buy and hold. it's not really managed. But again, like I say, it's, you know, some of these huge, very successful mutual fund guys, it's like they're a professional sports team coach, you know, where they command a high salary based upon their performance. So those fees get passed along to you. Now, those fees, if you're making incredible yields, who cares? I mean, the guy deserves it, or the gal, whatever, that whoever's managing the fund, the team, you know, they deserve to be compensated. But if they're charging you those huge fees and they're not getting that performance anymore, well, then they need to be sacked, or you need to move along to one that is. And so, when you're looking at mutual funds, you don't you look somewhat at the companies, and you should, but you also have the advantage of looking at things like Morningstar and some of these evaluation kind of companies, third party companies that judge the mutual funds and rate and you know, evaluate. So we'll talk a little about Morningstar in a second as well. So motives, so small initial investment, and it's super easier. Denominated in dollars, not even shares. I mean, the old school where we're, you know, the book talks about having to buy in even increments and all the rest of that. You have to buy in even shares typically, but you don't have to buy in whatever numbers. But let's say you want to invest, you know, $100 a month, $500 a month. That's dead easy. Mutual funds, that's just how it's done. With stocks, you know, you'd have to calculate how many shares, but it's not a lot of you know, math going on. But anyway, small initial investments. They usually have a minimum, like say 2,500 to start up a fund, but then they'll have some caveat in there. But with an automatic deposit of, you know, say $50 a month, we waive all that. So expertise of the portfolio manager, and let's hope he's worth it. Specific investment objectives. So there's a thing when you're buying a mutual fund, they have to give you some document, and it can be almost like an end user license agreement, you know, something that you don't read and you just kind of acknowledge that you should have read it. Anyway, but the prospectus tells you what they can and can't do, and in terms of investing, you know, we're going to invest in these markets, and if they do, you know, say they say they're international fund and they're investing domestically, you know, within the US, well, then that's a foul. They can't do that, you know, and so they won't do that typically because they don't want to be, you know, held legally responsible for that. So anyway, they'll have certain things that they'll strive to do, and you know, they'll try to state what risk they expect to see and all the rest of that. And so anyway, that's all laid out. All they basically put rules upon themselves in the prospectus. And rather than a stock price, you know, a price per share, they usually come up with a net asset value, which, you know, let's say a mutual fund's got 50 or 60 stocks that they're managing. It'd be difficult to count every one of those stocks and average it together and da, da, da. They don't typically do that. They typically will calculate that at the end of the day, and they refer to that as the net asset value. And these guys, they'll most mutual funds, because they're trying to manage things and they don't want people jumping in and out, they'll usually have some sort of prohibition of, you know, trading with high frequency. They don't like that. They want people to kind of buy and hold. And so typically with mutual funds, you can't buy intraday. You buy or you sell at the end of the day. And then yeah, there may be limits on the number of times per month where you can kind of get in and out. So anyway, but you can find them, you know, just as easily on those. They'll usually have a ticker symbol associated with the mutual fund, and you just type that into whatever graphing, whatever you know, internet source you're looking at to get the quotes, and that'll show right up. Load versus no load. So this is kind of like commission versus non-commission. There is no real good reason to be paying a load. A load is a commission. And there are some, you know, funds that you'll be contacted by some salesman and tell you that, well, obviously, if the salesman's involved, you know, he wants a little something for the effort, and so you're paying a commission. Now, it typically, you know, they do some good for you in the fact that they may motivate you to get investing, but in terms of the performance of them, now the person's a salesman trying to bring on new customers. Not he's not really spending much time, managing the fund. He's just managing to get more customers in there. So, and again, with any type of investment, the time value of money, if you pay a commission up front, it is costly because that money, even though it might be a small amount, you think, 10% or something, that could have turned into a whole lot of money if you would have left it in there for, typically 34 years till you retire. So loans can have a significant impact on investment performance, and that's what they're talking about. So here's a no load fund versus a load fund, but what are we going to do? We're not going to do the load fund. But anyway, this is just an example of no load fund. He does all this, amount received, and his return is 10%. Here's this. He whatever, paid that commission up front, and because of that, he bought fewer shares, the amount received. Anyway, cut his return nearly in half. Expense ratio. So this will be stated. Average. So again, Morningstar, the rating agency, and you can also take this into account. There's also some other fees, 12B-1 fees, and then other expenses. So you want to find a fund that has very low expenses, unless it's got huge yields, and then you're like, well, these people deserve, they're charging a higher expense ratio because they've got some really qualified talent. But if their performance doesn't match that, then switch funds. Okay, funds with lower expense ratios tend to outperform because part of that performance, part of that money, it's kind of like a loaded fund almost if you have super high expense ratios. Types of mutual funds. There are so many types. There could be page upon page on this. They're kind of like stocks, So growth funds would be companies that you wouldn't expect to pay a dividend. These are probably smaller companies that are growing, and you're going to probably make money by those shares, those stocks that they have appreciating in value, not so much paying a dividend. Here's one, the capital appreciation. Well, I mean, again, why would you not want that? You've got to look at the risk versus reward. There's no free lunch. If it's expected to grow at a very high rate, that's on a very good day. In a bad market, it is probably going to do very poorly. I'm not saying not to get involved in a very high rate, but it's not quite as simple as they portray going, oh, I want the highest rate available. Well, that is going to come with probably quite a bit of risk, the highest risk of those funds too. So depends which way you think the market's going. Small caps, so small companies, and there are numbers that go along with this in terms of billions, but it would be, whatever numbers that you would quickly forget. But a small cap by definition would be under a certain number of billions. Mid cap, they fit in that definitions. And then large caps are, sort of like blue chip companies, big established companies, huge capitalizations. Equity income, when you see income, that means dividend, right? Income means probably a large stable company. And this is actually the way they've got it listed here is probably about right because a large cap would typically be an equity income fund. Balanced. So again, they're just going to put in words that can be defined many ways. Sectors can be done in so many different ways. It can be sectors like industry, it can be sectors like regions, it can be sectors like, not going to do any environmental harm, some sort of sustainable ethical type thing. You can find there's more mutual funds than there are stocks out there. And so again, whatever you want to get involved in, you can probably find a mutual fund that matches that. Now, is their performance always good? Yeah. But, they're trying to sell it. Technology, biotech, socially responsible, that's another term that's used for, some of the ethically managed ones. International. So I kind of touched on this before. You can have a global fund. Global means everywhere, to include the US. International means everywhere but the US. Index funds. Index will just pick an index, like say the S&P 500 or the Dow or whatever, an index. And what's happened over time is the reason there's indices out there is that when people say, "How's the market doing today?" Well, if you only rated that on General Motors stock, I mean, it's kind of a broad question. So that's why they get a collection of stocks. And so one of the big ones that you always hear about is the Dow. Now, you don't go out typically and buy it. I mean, you could, I guess, buy the indice of the Dow. But what the Dow means, I mean, the original creation of this was more for news reporting. They get a whole bunch of stocks that they think are representative of the U.S. market, and they put them under this indice. They call that the Dow, and then they say the Dow's up 200 points or down 200 points or whatever. And so it ties those sort of reports not to an individual company, but to a broader, economy type thing, not just even one industry. So anyway, the theory behind index funds, again, as they talk about in the podcast, is to really minimize those fees. And I don't know whether they're going to go out of fashion now because, it could be argued that we're in a much more challenging investment time and that not all boats are going to be rising with the tide, that, some are going to be sinking and you got to be more, strategic and do more research and pick individual stocks. I don't know. The theories are out there. Other type of stock funds, so can be all kinds. Exchange traded funds, yeah, they can be like index funds, but this gets around the deal where I said they're traded at the end of the day. This one you can buy in and out through the day, because mutual funds are so large that some of the, big companies that you would go to if you were trading stocks, they felt like they were being kind of left out, and they wanted kind of a hybrid product where, there's a fund that's traded on the exchange, and so it just adds another element to it. But those are ETFs. anyway, I'm not a big investor in those, but they would work. I mean, there's no reason to get them. I'm going to look at a bunch of different funds. I've got about four different companies out there. There's a bunch of reputable companies. What you're going to find is you're going to go to work for an employer and they're going to put out, pardon me, some of their investment things. And they're going to say, okay, for mutual funds, we've got Vanguard or a company I used to work with at Voya, which is a Dutch Netherlands company. And anyway, sometimes that will ultimately be the choice because your employer has kind of driven this. And since the employer's putting money into your fund and you can't do a whole lot with it while you're still employed by them, they're kind of driving your choice. So that's fine. Or sometimes they'll have a couple companies. But UAA, for example, was associated with Fidelity and they're just fine. In fact, they're better now, I think. They weren't one of the ones that prohibited trading on the whole Robinhood thing. And they're the TD Ameritrade stuff, that's changed a little bit because, TD stands for Toronto Dominion, as in the folks who were freezing people's bank accounts a little while ago with the problems in Canada. So I'm not sure I want to be with those folks. But anyway, types of other bond. So we talked more about equities. Now here's some bond funds, treasury bond funds. They're going to be very secure. Not much activity. Ginnie Mae. So these are going to be in government mortgages or government sponsored mortgages. Again, not high risk. Corporate bond. Now this could be a little bit more exciting because they're corporate bonds where the companies could, potentially default on you. Junk bonds, yep. You can get a whole bunch of crummy bonds, bonds that are about to default, put them together and offer some spectacular yields until they fail. They may not fail, but they probably will. And then mutual bond funds, which would be some of the, like for stadiums or other things that municipalities may be engaged in. Just a second. Okay, index bond funds, again, a specified bond index. So just like the others, there are indexes for bonds, indices. International bonds, global bonds, and then maturity classification. So it's going to relate to their just like the underlying bonds where they have maturities that can be staggered, short term, long term. All right. Investing in a mutual fund. Typically, if you're smart, I typically just check reinvest. Otherwise, you'd be getting small little checks. Let's say these stocks that are held in the mutual funds are paying dividends. You could get those things, those small dividends, but it just creates a lot of work and it takes them out from that mutual fund. You're probably better off ticking the little box that says reinvest dividends and capital gains. So when they buy and sell stocks or when they earn dividends, you're entitled to those, but the easiest thing is to have them reinvested right into your account. And then if you actually sell the shares, you will perhaps, for a better price than what you paid for, you'll get a capital gain. So ST, short term, long term, and just how they did it. Okay, risk from stock and mutual, same as the stocks that are underlying. Now, more diversification. If a single company happens to go under, hopefully you'll have some protection because you've got more than just that one company stock. And the same thing with, risk and return. The more risk that you happen to take, should be reflected in a higher return. That's what you have to evaluate when you're looking at investments. There's nothing wrong with taking risk if the return is there and it's in line with, kind of your risk tolerance and in the current direction of the market. So moderate high risk, nothing new there. Bond funds, same thing with the interest rate risk. If interest rates go up, your bond performance is going to suffer a little bit because it's typically earning the old rate and therefore it's not as attractive. So, this is a gross, generalization here. Different, there's different, yeah, representing a broad index. I guess they put that qualifier on there, but there's indexes for very conservative stocks, and there's indexes that cover just very speculative technology type things. So, depends. Income fund. That's probably about where it should be. Big, large companies that are paying dividends, balanced growth and income, growth stocks, smaller ones, capital appreciation, so getting more aggressive. Global, so now you're looking at not only does it have to grow, but it has to deal with politics and things that are typically more turbulent than the US, plus currency fluctuations. They put technology, anyway, there's some Technology is typically much more aggressive because it's fast changing. Companies come and go. And then foreign stock, yeah, on one small country. Well, is this country Switzerland or is this country, whatever, some sub-Saharan African country? So huge. Anyway, hard to say. But anyway, big picture is, lower risk and high risk, high return. So that's just the nature of the business. They talked last time or mentioned about some of the stock scandals. There was Bernie Madoff, which that's getting kind of dated now, but he was a guy who just took people's money and it was a pyramid scheme. So he'd bring in, get new money from new investors, and he'd pay it out to the people who are already investing. And he was, these people were getting like 25% a year after year, and there was just phenomenal. And there was no explanation why he was able to get these huge returns, and nobody asked any questions. Well, obviously, it was just a pyramid scheme. He was using the money that he was taking in, paying it to the people that were already established, and then taking a little bit for himself. And anyway, if you're getting that high of return, uncharacteristic of the rest of the market, you probably need to do your due diligence and figure out what's going on. And maybe it's just exceptional luck, but with Bernie Madoff, there was none of that. He was just a crook. So anyway, bond rates. So long-term T-bond. So interest rate risk. Okay, because you're locking in the interest rate risk, the chance that the interest rate's going to change. Well, it's going to be much higher risk if you're stuck in it for a long time. Short-term bond, if the rates change, well, the bond term was quite low, and so you could get out of it. So your minimum exposure low because this is, like we said, mortgage-backed security, short-term corporate bonds, so not a lot of exposure in terms of time. A little bit more, we're up in a moderate because it's corporate bonds rather than government bonds, but a little bit higher return. Short-term high-yield bond fund, they're putting that in high but low interest rate risk. And then over here in the corner, long-term high-yield bond fund. So you're in basically junk bonds and you're locked into that for a long time. So anyway, not, pretty intuitive how that all works. So longer term bonds, most sensitive. Consider the default risk, the company going under. That's why the government and municipal bonds are less risk because they typically can just raise taxes rather than go out of business. And then bond funds, interest rate risk, default risk are both. So conservative, real estate based. And then junk bonds. They've already been rated, below B. They've already been assessed to be at high risk, and that's when you're jumping in. So, anyway. So, government securities, mortgages, more government, intermediate mortgages, and then out here at the end, high yield, one country. Big problems. This gets into speculation. But this gets into you're not keeping up with inflation. So you need somewhere in the middle, or my preference is not really with bonds anyway, be more in equities. Determine your investment objectives, evaluate your risk tolerance. So the time to realize whether you can handle, the market going down for a couple of years is when you're making the investments, not when the market goes down. I mean, it's too late. You need to say, I can live with it. I, would like to make money year after year, but if it goes down for a couple of years, I'm in it for the long term and I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. Fair enough. So selecting mutual funds. So this prospectus, remember when I told you a brief statement about the general goal? It's more than a brief statement. I mean, it's page upon page. And it tells you what they are going to do, what they can purchase. It's got to have their performance in there and other things. And it's kind of the sales brochure, but it's better than that because it's the legal documentation that if they don't do what they say they're going to do in that prospectus. Now they can't, guarantee any kind of return, but they can't run off and invest in, some country or something that they didn't state or get involved in some type of, super risky investment that they didn't agree to, that you didn't acknowledge in the prospectus. So it ties their hands to a certain amount, and they generally won't violate it because you could sue them if they did. Fees and expenses. So generally don't pay a load. A redemption fee, back-end load, this means that they take a little something at the end when you redeem it. Not a great situation, but not bad. I mean, if they're confident enough to think that they're going to be around in 30 years when I pull this money out, and that their return, they've got some skin in the game, their return is based upon how well the fund does. I like that. So they're incentivized to make the maximum amount possible. Whereas if they take the commission up the front, they sold it to you, it's your problem now. So anyway, any kind of commission is not great, but if they want to put it on the back end or the redemption, that shows some positive characteristics. Anyway, always risk, your underlying securities, generally equities, generally stocks. Yeah, things can go wrong. Distribution, and this is where I said there will be a little block on there to say, how would you like, dividends and capital gains? My pups have quieted down. No puppies were hurt. She got her foot caught in the under the chair. All right. Minimum investment, minimum balance. Super user friendly, super low balance, and you just online, you just adjust it. You want to take a percentage of your salary or percentage of, a dollar figure. It's and you want to adjust it. It's just, I mean, slick websites, very well done, just really pleasant to deal with. How to buy or redeem. I would typically be a little more careful, two-factor authentication and other stuff, because these are not things that you're going to be touching every day. And you don't want to go in there and find out that your balance is, wacky and you didn't notice it until 6 months too late. So I would have a fairly high threshold, especially for the redeeming of shares. So it's up to you. There are your choices. Consider the fall tables fund. So what are they going to show us here? Yeah, I think I eliminated that because it was kind of generic, and we're going to look at the actual website. So again, they talk about Fidelity. There's also the mutual fund companies themselves have, a mutual fund education type thing. But the smart person, smart student who's trying to do their term project would be going to these websites and, kind of forming their term project based upon all the resources that are available to you, because these guys are trying to draw you in. You are their prime, demographic they want. They realize you may not, if especially if you're college, you may not have much money yet, but if they can get you locked in as a customer now, they've got you for life. So they are very eager to make things very, slick and helpful and geared to the types of questions you're looking for in the term project. I did get an email regarding the format on the term project. I do not care. Whatever works for you. It doesn't have to be some APA thing or whatever. Don't, monkey with the margins and use huge boldface type to try and, make a one-page paper 4 pages. But, in terms of the way you want to structure it and the format, I'm not worried about that. I'm just focused on the content. So mutual funds, how they're quoted. So again, you're going to want to know basically the ticker symbol, Net asset value, which equates to the stock price, how much did it go up and down, how much did it gain over the year, 3-year rate, all good stuff to know. So net asset value, that's the price change year to date. Be careful when you're looking at numbers, though. Sometimes they'll cherry pick numbers when they say, "Oh, the best performing fund since whenever," and they'll pick some date that puts them smack dab in the middle of, March 2020 of the Corona drop or something, and they'll show some great return. So it's helpful to look at where the starting and end points are. Dividend, last net change. But again, you could find these type of things in, I guess the print address, Wall Street Journal, but most people are going to use online sources. This was the website I was talking about, the Mutual Fund Education Association, I guess it is. We can look at that. Let me step back through, see if there's anything else. One thing about diversification of mutual funds, I've caught myself doing this a couple times where I've had two or three different mutual funds, offered by different employers or whatever, and you think you've got some diversification, and you look at the underlying equities because they will tell you what, say, their top 10 holdings are, and you'll see, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, whatever, and you think you had diversification because the names of the funds were different. But if you look at their top holdings, in this case, they all seem to glom onto what would be sort of the tech sector or, whatever rapidly growing company. So, and they weren't bad companies, but I certainly wasn't diversified, even though I had a number of different funds. The funds themselves had kind of the same stocks. So, and sometimes diversification for diversification's sake, like you've heard me talk kind of poorly about bonds, and people think, well, you need to diversify, you need some bonds. Well, no, I don't. Not if they're not doing well. I mean, I whatever. I you don't need to diversify to when there's strong reason to know that a certain sector is not performing well, don't feel like you have to own part of that to be diversified. Even, I'm not some vulture type person, but there's people who say, oh, defense sector is going to go up because of the heightened conflict and all that. I've kind of been there, done that. I mean, the defense stocks are not great. I always lose money in defense stocks and biotech stuff, medical stuff. I've never done very well in any of those. And they're usually these kind of old, especially in defense sector, kind of old, stodgy companies that don't have great growth rates anyway. So, anyway, people who, anyway, it's again, it's sometimes some of the free advice you get is not worth it's what it's worth. But anyway, you look at the data, look at some of the other sources, and move on from there. Impact of financial crisis, international diversification. Again, globalization kind of flies right into this. So, because of the competitive nature of mutual funds, and say you're aligned with something like Fidelity, and all of a sudden you see, the mutual funds of, oh, I don't know, Vanguard or, T. Rowe Price or one of these other big investment firms, that their funds are doing better, and you're thinking, well, I need to switch companies. You'll probably find that even under, say, Fidelity, you can buy their competitors' products just because Fidelity, in this case, wants to keep you as a customer, and they don't want you to go to another, company. So, variation, interest rates, stocks, European funds. Just as you think. The Canadian, Canadian stock market is kind of the Wild West. Most people think Canada is a very calm, and in terms of investing, because of all their mining stocks, it is the Wild West. There's a lot of, I'd almost say, shady things that go on in the Canadian market, stock market. Hedge funds. Okay, so now these guys would be, getting hyper aggressive in terms of jumping in and out, and for high wealth individuals, and sometimes they do very, very well, and other times they get clobbered. But anyway, here they talk about the Madoff scandal. Yeah, investors should have been suspicious when they kept getting money, getting high returns year after year. So I'm not, I have nothing bad necessarily to say about hedge funds, but again, it's a broad term. They're going to talk about the ones that do very well, but nobody really talks about ones that fail. So, and then when we're getting hedge funds, we're also stepping away from investing and we're getting more into speculation. And some homework. So 10%. So when somebody says, oh, I'm going to go with the tax-free, the tax-exempt bond or whatever, and you have to do a little bit of math to figure out what's the better deal. You need to know what the interest rate is, and you need to know what your tax rate is. In this case, they're saying the person's 28%, so meaning that you would basically multiply this 10.2 by 0.72, which equates to the 72% of the money you get to keep. And if 0.72 times 10.2 is more than 7.9, it's a good deal. If it's less, it's a bad deal. So, simple stock question. Interest rates in the overall economy. So just think about that. Because you're holding a bond at the current rate. If the rates go up or down, how does that affect the desirability of that bond that you're holding? And here's just another question about that. So now that we rolled through that, the podcast, it is 15 points. It's out there already on the assignments. It's from 2016, so golly, it doesn't seem like it's that old, but it's getting old. I just want to go to that mutual fund website real quick. Have quiet dogs all day, and then all of a sudden, anyway, mutual fund investor. So this is paid for by, the mutual fund companies. But again, data by Morningstar. Morningstar is the company that really evaluates things. So here's Morningstar themselves. You could go on a Morningstar and maybe you could sign up for free, but they're probably going to take your credit card and it's probably going to start billing you. You can sign in, you can do all sorts of stuff directly with Morningstar, or you can go to one of your mutual fund companies and let's look at their mutual funds. And if you have an account with them, they'll probably give you access to Morningstar data if they're, worthwhile. So let's explore their fund offering. All mutual funds. So there's going to be different names. Everything's going to be somewhat, though, familiar. I mean, fund picks from Fidelity. So these are the ones the company owns and recommends. 4 and 5 star funds. When they're saying 4 and 5 star, that's according to Morningstar's ratings. So there's some Morningstar information coming through. Again, they know, most people know that, well, Fidelity says it's the best. Well, of course, when it's their stuff, they're going to say it's the best. When it's Morningstar's 5 star funds, then, and again, they're going to keep citing Morningstar throughout their sector. Here's a sector fund. So, let's look at some of their sector funds, Morningstar's highly rated ones. And so here's an automotive, a technology, global technology, real estate, precious metals. So if you've got some reason to think that something is amazing, see, here's a T. Rowe Price, here's a Putnam. So that some of their competitors' stuff that they're offering, health, real estate, so all the different categories, global real estate, utilities. So there's just so many things out there. And if we roll over to the top here, kill these dogs. Morningstar's equate, their ratings, yields, the semiconductors, there's a huge shortage. If you would have been in there, you would have done quite well, but for some reason it's down a little bit today. Life of the fund, pretty darn good though. So I mean, there's chances if you have a feeling and have some strategy behind it, you could have done quite well. Now a lot of things had to line up for that, but here's Vanguard. Again, I don't really have any loyalty to any of these guys. I have reasons to dislike some of them when I see them doing some nefarious things, but in terms of the companies themselves, become an owner. Lot of high dollar, all these pictures, everything's been tested, and T. Rowe Price, whatever, these guys are slick. Let's look at something in terms of, looking at employee sponsor, personal investing, institutional investing, all kinds of things, and all types of things in here for personal investing in terms of, let's say, how are you going to save for education? Part of your plan there, 529 plans. We've discussed that a little bit. We'll discuss a little bit more later. But basically, any of the money generated out of that, any of the income you generate from that, as long as it's used for educational purposes, it's tax-free. So, general investing solutions. And let's look at retirement because that's probably going to have a lot of the calculators and things in it that you'd want. So, IRAs, individual IRAs, 401ks, planning for retirement. So you may have like life cycle funds where you tell them basically when you want to retire and they track it. Income calculators, investment allocate. Anyway, all types of things that you can use. And don't make your term paper just a collection of screenshots. But if you see some graph or something that's useful and kind of tailored to your numbers, I would use it. Again, you don't, we haven't logged in. I haven't given them any personal data. If you do give these people your email, yeah, expect to be bombarded from now till forever. But there's worse things to be getting emails. They're probably trying to get you in the right direction. This was when I was talking about we're kind of all in the, mutual fund business. This is the PFD. So you can see the PFD is kind of set up like a mutual fund. 38% is public equities. Public equities would be like stocks. Real estate, They own stuff. They probably got beat up a little bit. I think they owned a lot of like shopping malls and stuff back in the DC area. I know they owned the building that the company that I work for, that's not at all associated with Alaska. Anyway, when people think that the PFD comes from the price of oil, no, you don't see any energy in here. They took the money from the proceeds and then invested it in other things. So this is, the PFD amount will be higher when these investments do well, but this is not tied directly to the price of oil by any stretch. So Yeah, it's a pretty good overview of what mutual funds are about. But you really don't know anything about mutual funds though if you don't know anything about stocks, because they're all made up of underlying assets. In fact, let me do one more thing here. So we're going to go Fidelity Select. This is the semiconductor one, and we just want to kind of explore it a little bit so you can see the charts, you can see all that stuff. And this is what I'm talking about, the holdings. So huge in NVIDIA, great company. Marvell Technology, Microchip. I mean, these are going to be all the big, I guess they call them fabs. Anyway, the big people who make chips. So, if you have two mutual funds that are involved in semiconductors, you probably don't have much diversification because they probably own all of those same companies. Whereas you get a different sector. I think I'm in sector funds, aren't I? No. In general. Automortal portfolio. Let's see what they've got. Tesla, Toyota, General Motors, O'Reilly, Ferrari. Interesting. So, if you wanted to buy stock in Ferrari, you can see they don't even have a ticker symbol listed. It would be pretty much impossible for here's some, Japanese ones. I've got what is it? NIO. It's a Japanese or a Chinese electric car EV company. But here's a way that you can quite easily be invested in Ferrari and some other things. This is, everything from Tesla to, old school Ford and GM, people who were on the brink of bankruptcy just a few years ago, to electric cars. So you can see how you gain some diversification on this one perfectly. People have got to drive, right? And you don't care. You're going to make money whether they're driving an EV or whether they're driving a Ford. You're in that sector. So this probably best illustrates what I'm trying to say about diversification. People are going to drive. I'm not holding a single company. I'm holding companies that, although they're all in transportation, they couldn't be further, And as Tesla grows, Ford's probably going to shrink. Or if, Ford grows, whatever, they're going to balance each other out. And so you're going to get diversification in that way. And whoever wins, you don't care as long as it's one of those 10. So anyway, that's about it. We'll talk more next week.